Good morning, Michael. Election results are challenged on both sides, and we're still yet to hear the final result. And still to come are challenges in...
Well, you know, I'm not sure that President Trump is ever going to concede this election. But I think we'll have a result here probably by the end of this week. In fact, if you look at the way things are trending in Pennsylvania, I think the Biden campaign feels very confident that things will go Vice President Biden's way there. And as for the legal challenges that you alluded to, I think it's important for your viewers to understand that the fact that you bring a legal challenge without any basis in law in terms of either statutory or constitutional violations does not give that challenge any merit. Essentially, it's like tweeting something with a filing fee. It's completely irrelevant, and I think most, if not all, of the legal challenges...
...as friends of America is that that internal divisions are so deep that it would take some time to heal them. How long?
Well, this is a much larger issue, and of course, I am happy that from my perspective, Vice President Biden is uniquely situated among U.S. politicians to be able to govern in a way that unites Americans. He has a long history of friendships across the aisle with people like John McCain and Dick Lugar and many, many others. And so he's used to working in a bipartisan fashion. That's sort of almost second nature for him. So I do think he's well suited to healing the divisions in our country. But there is something sociologically speaking that is very troubling that won't be cured simply by one man being in office, even if he does the very best that he can. And that's going to take a lot of effort on the part of civil society.
Okay, let's move on to the U.S. relations with Europe, which under President Trump suffered a lot. In an article in The Politico, you refer to five ways in which those rifts could be healed and relations restored. There are five areas. It's trade, climate, arms control, democracy, and the rule of law, including urgently re-establishing the credibility of Article 5 in the NATO treaty. I presume this is not an exhaustive list, but...
Well, energy security is, of course, essential both for economic prosperity, but also for hard security. And so I think one of the key things that the United States is going to have to try to lead together with our European partners is a much more concerted effort to deal with the non-military threats to transatlantic security. And so if you look at how NATO has evolved over the last 4 or 5 years, you see that our military capabilities remain pretty robust and things are on the right track. But if you look at our ability to withstand non-military threats in terms of energy coercion, in terms of disinformation, dark money, cyber attacks, we're lagging behind in those areas. And those are areas that are not just simply areas that NATO can tackle as a military organization. It requires the EU and it requires the entire transatlantic community coming together, sharing intelligence and adopting much more rigorous policies, for example, to combat dark money or to provide for greater energy security through a diversity of supplies.
Quote one of the most quintessential lines in your article. Europe's existential threat is a matter of governance. It is the threat of the corrupt oligarchization of European politics that could eventually erode decision-making across the continent. And my question is that many EU leaders prefer to confine their critique to Eastern Europe and the new member states. However, you quite rightfully extend the scope and the concern of oligarchization of EU politics to all of Europe. Many in Brussels probably would return the ball to US itself, but where does this threat of oligarchization end?
Well, this is something that we really contend with across the globe. In fact, I see the threat of oligarchic authoritarianism as sort of the defining feature of geopolitics in the 21st century. And if you just look at my own country under the presidency of Donald Trump, you see how law enforcement, intelligence agencies, diplomatic services have all been politicized the judiciary has become politicized. And this is a real danger to democracy because it consolidates both political and economic power in the hands of a narrow elite, which is sort of the definition of oligarchy. And the danger really is on two levels. On the one hand, it leads to a less democratic system and a more authoritarian system over time. And that in itself is very troubling. But it also opens up avenues of influence for foreign powers to be able to manipulate the system through the weaponization of corruption. And we've seen that in the United States with Russian influence, but we've seen it with across the transatlantic community and across the world.
I think now, and it's not often debated in political circles, but fighting just from a perspective of someone living in Eastern Europe, and particularly in Bulgaria, fighting back oligarchy is a tough mission for societies with weak institutions and corrupt elites. Politicians in Brussels and Washington often indicate that it is not their task to criticize governments of allies or strategic partners. Yet, oligarchs and corrupt officials often receive EU funds and red carpet reception in Western capitals. Would a Biden administration restore the balance between economic interests and basic values channeled via large banks in old Europe, not in Eastern Europe?
Well, you know, I think the Magnitsky Act is one tool, but what I think is necessary is for much more concerted pressure and incentives to be constructed so that we don't see the further oligarchization of politics across Europe. This is a real challenge. And, you know, back in the 1990s, when a lot of the countries of Eastern Europe were aspirants for NATO or EU membership, those two institutions had a tremendous amount of power, and they were able to either compel or encourage a lot of reforms that prevented oligarchs from seizing either economic or political power and to keep the electoral system competitive and pluralistic. Now that a lot of countries in Eastern Europe have integrated into those two institutions, a lot of that leverage has disappeared in terms of the accession process. But that doesn't mean that Washington and Brussels don't have leverage. And that's where I think we've made a huge mistake in recent years, is by not realizing that Washington and Brussels still have a lot of leverage, and we need to exercise it. We cannot tolerate.
To home or the Black Sea and the Balkans, the challenges that NATO faces and the energy dimension of security issues. Turkey, for example, under President Erdogan, has become much more assertive. And it's not only Greece that it considers as opponent. It's the whole zero problem with the neighbors mantra of the near past that is in shadows. Currently, Ankara has conflicts with almost all its neighbors. You refer to Trump's cozy relationship with President Recep Tayyip Erdogan and his transactional diplomacy, which essentially is engage in business deals and forget about principles. Adding to the security challenges posed by Russia in the Black Sea, Turkey seems adamant to reckon. How a Biden administration would address this concern?
Well, I think a lot of the aggressive and bellicose behavior that we've seen from Turkey over the last few years is a real danger to the cohesion of NATO as an alliance, as well as Turkey's democratic backsliding. It is considered by the Committee to Protect Journalists as the country with the most number of imprisoned journalists of any country in the entire world. That's not acceptable for a NATO member. So this is going to be one of the most important and difficult relationships that a Biden administration will have to tackle from day one, is how to incentivize Turkey to play a more constructive role in the Black Sea area, in the South Caucasus, in the Aegean, in the Eastern Med. There are a lot of potential win-win outcomes for the EU countries and Turkey if they work together. Unfortunately, none of that has come to fruition over the last few years. In fact, as you noted, President Erdogan has conflicts essentially with every one of Turkey's neighbors. But hopefully,
Trump has quite a few friends among the soft autocrats, as they are referred to, Viktor Orban, Andrzej Duda, Miloš Zeman, the Slovenian Prime Minister Janez Janša. And I believe that our Prime Minister falls in this category. And each one of them is playing his own transactional diplomacy game, offering business deals in return for muted U.S. reaction to his slide to autocracy and erosion of key democratic institutions. How will a future Biden administration cope with these challenges?
Well, again, as I said earlier, I think it's going to be crucial for the Biden administration to take the integrity of democratic norms and rule of law very, very seriously in all of its relationships with its NATO and EU partners. This is not something that can be treated as peripheral. This is central to our value-based diplomacy. Now, I am a firm believer that a lot of the security relationships need to remain intact, and that we can't use necessarily security as leverage to compel certain actions in the human rights sphere. But certainly, we should elevate the dialogue on democracy and human rights and make it central to the bilateral relationship. It can't be the case that there are countries in Europe that are moving...
Your articles that I refer there, one is in Newsweek and the other in Politico, but it might come as a revelation to many of our viewers, not only in Bulgaria, but across the region. You say, and that's the beginning of the quote, the Trump administration is so corrupt, our diplomats can no longer raise concerns about corruption or abuse of power without sounding hypocritical. Well, let me give you my sort of reading. On July the 15th this year, Secretary of State Mark Pompeo warned companies and suppliers involved in the construction of the Turk Stream that unless they wind up operation, sanctions will be imposed. 3 months later, a U.S. company supplies gas turbines for the most essential and critical part of the Turk Stream, which are the compressor stations. Does this example fit into the...
Well, it absolutely is an example of the hypocritical nature of this administration, lecturing other countries on rule of law, even as the president tweets things that are directly antithetical to rule of law here at home. It makes our diplomacy completely discombobulated. With regards to TurkStream, I can't tell you for sure, but I know there is a move afoot with the NDAA, which is the National Defense Authorization Act. It's one of the biggest bills that gets passed every year to fund the Pentagon and the defense and military enterprise in the United States. And there is a...
Thank you. And on the Western Balkans, the Prespa agreement seems to have been rated as a success, but currently Republic of Northern Macedonia and Albania are also facing possible delays in starting EU accession negotiations. In most of those instances, Russia, both directly and indirectly, nourishes old and new antagonisms with the proficient use of oligarchs as intermediaries. The Serbia-Kosovo economic normalization agreement seems a step in the right direction, but inter-ethnic and interstate conflicts continue to be exploited by Russia, Turkey and China to the detriment of NATO's interests in the region. Do you believe that a more active engagement from the US might seem warranted as EU accession talks are pushed back in time, and NATO seems to be the only shared platform for most countries? Of course, Serbia is a special case.
Well, I do think that the U.S. needs to play a much more engaged role in the Western Balkans, but I also think that the U.S. needs to synchronize its policies with our European friends much more closely. This has been the real tragedy of the Trump administration, is that it has completely taken itself away from the EU in terms of the diplomacy in the region and pursued its own track, ignoring what the EU is doing and sometimes even undermining it. So what's really necessary is for the US and our EU friends to align our strategic visions, but then also to seek to synchronize our tactical advances diplomatically in the region. I think we can do that on the Kosovo-Serbia talks. I think we can do that on North Macedonia to further tether it into Euro-Atlantic structures. And I think we can do that in terms of combating corruption and organized crime in the region, which is an interest that we both have.
Super. Well, final question is, of course, apart from the divergences with the Trump administration, there will be certainly areas of continuity in U.S. foreign policy. And one of the reasons why, because there's in Congress, there's bipartisan support on some critical issues, such as the... how will the Biden administration rate Eastern Europe and the Black Sea in its priority list?
Well, you know, I can't really speak directly for a future Biden administration, but my hope is that it will prioritize the Black Sea to a much greater degree than we've seen in the last couple of years. And I think there is, as you say, bipartisan support for expanding our transatlantic cooperation to counter threats from both Russia and China, which are very different, by the way. They often get lumped together. But those are two very different sets of toolboxes that we need to push back on Chinese influence on the one hand and on Russian influence on the other. But, you know, I'm hopeful that in a post-Trump era that some of the Republican members of Congress, both in the Senate and the House, revert to a sort of more traditional stance in terms of supporting projects that build transatlantic unity and that push back on Russian-Chinese influence, and that we can find common ground to be able to move out and develop that sort of transatlantic cooperation that's necessary on things like investment screening mechanisms.
And best wishes on the outcome from the from this presidential race. I hope to hear more from you.
Thank you, Ilya. Great to be with you.